in energy field work, we have a tendency to view the body as this mystical thing, which it's not. It can't be. And that energy can come from a chakra, because that's where somebody's coming from. Somebody can blast from a chakra. Well, that doesn't mean that chakra's open. It's the intent. And if the intention is to integrate, if our intention is always clear to integrate, our chakras work in that open fountaining effect, as opposed to just blasting it. It's almost like what came up out of our talking about age. When we were talking about Ida's incredible wisdom, as opposed to somebody who's new at the experience, our first attempts at energy or coming from a certain place is obnoxious. Because we don't know what to do with that energy, we don't know what that level is, and everything is a test or a trial or a... And then at one point, the chakra itself opens and has maturity and balance. And then from that space, you can then focus and be specific if your need is to do that. But that you have the open flow and the flexibility and the mobility of your energy within certain realms. It's like the person who becomes a psychic and spends 55 years of their life in psychic work doing past life readings. I'm not sure that's real expanding for that person. And I'm sure that would age a person, as you were saying. Yeah, that's where you could get real locked into that as a way of perception and not see, or the person who does that kind of reading and doesn't relate it to the here and now, you know, worse yet, where it has no bearing on life necessarily, it's just kind of an interesting thing to talk about over cocktails. And one of the things that seems to be coming up is how people express what Rolfing is. What I see going on in society is that people are no longer interested in those casual kinds of remarks. They're more interested among themselves, even when they don't know that that's what's going on, in a more personal kind of relationship. And I think that society itself is shifting. Probably here we have more openness to that than we do in other parts of the country. But we have a more open, just as we have chakras that can be open and exchange energy. When you get that tunnel, you don't get anything back. When you start putting out of the throat or out of the heart in a tunnel and you get a blast, there is no room for interface with anyone else. It's like the stuff that comes from the lower chakras when they're not connected to the upper chakras. It's almost ego, or not ego, the Alice Bailey word glamour is better, because ego should not be made a bad word. It's that aspect of man trying to do his thing without God, kind of aspect that's real single-minded. And if the chakra then is open in some way, then there's room for communication, there's room for exploring, there's room for examining models, there's room for other things. And it doesn't matter which level it's on, and I guess the chakras are maybe only indicative of levels. Mm-hmm. And that rather than having an open chakra, what we need is open chakras. And I see the value in Rolfing in being that it opens chakras. It opens the system so that there's a place for open models and open communications and open thought. Because what it really does is get a broad band of color, mm-hmm. that's always been an aspect. I think it's important. Did I answer your question? Or did I ramble?
You did answer my question, and I don't know how to focus on to get it more answered. And somehow I keep going back to the idea that we're tending to look at the opening of the chakras as something that happens like this, you know, level
yeah.
by level
yeah,
by level,
it does.
And it happens like this. You know, in concentric circles out.
Maybe if you looked at it as a diamond, and when you polish one facet, you get a facet, and you polish another facet, you don't get two facets. You get a refraction and a quality of light, and then as each facet is polished, you get a compendium of light that glorifies until the end.
Right.
And that also leaves open the issue of you can have a lot of facets and a lot of non-facets, mm-hmm. and it still works fine.
Yeah.
Yes. I wanted to talk to you about releasing also. When I'm doing energy work on someone else, I'm not always assured that I am released out of their field after I'm finished. Just wondering if you could shed some enlightenment back.
Well, it's always a question of protection when you work with other people. and ultimate protection is your willingness to participate with them and move out of the experience. You know, we talk in my field about white light protecting you from everything, and it doesn't. You know, it totally doesn't protect you. And what you do is you put up your white light usually too late and take it home with you. So what you did is you took the entity, whatever it was, the thought form that fell out, and you take it home. And you be it for a while, you know. You do real dumb things.
You're domesticated.
Yeah, whatever. But that goes back to the fact that we attract to us experiences that we need. And the issue of releasing has to do with being real clear about them being there and you being here, and though you're attracted by your magic facets and by the things that are going on with them that are going on with you, that is their experience and this is your experience, and what the mirror is there for is to look at to see if you want to go home that way.
I often have experiences that I feel as if I'm someone else.
Well, that's because you're taking it in.
And now, since I've been here, I've been having those experiences, and I've been watching. So I feel like I'm me and them. Does that make sense?
Well, and in terms of cosmic consciousness, that's who you are. Because you're here with them, therefore you're them.
But it is important that you do maintain your identity at this point, because you're not at cosmic consciousness level yet.
Still 26.
No, it is important. I'm sure it's fine. Okay, Carol.
I was just trying to figure out for how far we each have to go to cosmic consciousness. I just wanted to say a couple things. One is that I really appreciate all of you being here. I've really gotten more depth and a sort of a more. I've had a lot of new spaces put in this last couple of weeks, but this has sort of solidified some of them and made them more useful for me. And so I can run around in this new play yard a lot easier. I appreciate all the parts that were put in. Plan to have a lot of fun playing on the swings and all that. The other thing I just want to mention, which is, in many ways I'm talking to myself, but I wanted to mention something about what Bruce said about that this is not, what we're doing here is not really to be shared with other people, beginning offers and so forth. I think that's, in a sense, basically true, but we could say almost the same things, except possibly let's wave our hands over people and look for chakras. And they wouldn't hear it, because none of us, I think, could have heard this before. And I know Ida's been saying a lot of the same things, or things that could have been interpreted in this way for years. And I, for one, have not really heard it on this level. So we've really got a multi-dimensional language at this point, with only a few things that I really think we should just keep our mouths shut about, where most of the rest of it is will be learned slowly but surely on different levels by the people as they come through, as we provide them with an atmosphere to learn it and help them with their growth so they can come to a place where they can hear it as we can.
I don't have any questions at this point, but I do want to say I didn't have any questions this morning, but I really want to acknowledge you people for sharing what you did share, and that I got a lot of answers without having questions.
Touché.
And that's really neat for me, and a lot of insights came through today in enormous amounts of ways, and I'm sure we'll be processing that for quite a while. So I just will take a moment to acknowledge the three of you and of course, the rest of the class have been doing that all week for helping me participate in all of this on a higher consciousness. So thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
I'd like to share a few thoughts. I'm not sure whether that question or not. I think that the reason that Ida has been talking about roughing the way she's been talking is not just to keep us out of jail, but also because she wanted to keep us talking about the physics of consciousness. In an age where metaphysics was really popular, and there was a kind of sort of an attitude of superiority, that metaphysics was somehow better than physics. And what I'm getting out of all this is that metaphysics is simply, at this point of time, beyond physics. And that we don't understand these energy forms very well, and so it's out there and it looks kind of airy-fairy is the term I use, but that it's really some direct relationship to what we call physics, and that the higher expression of Rawlkin is really the physics of consciousness.
Would it be fun when we get Meta Rawlkin?
She has brought through two really important thoughts for me, which I keep kind of plugging back into, which have to do with the relationship of gravity to human behavior, and this thought that the spatial arrangement of elements has a lot to do with the flow of those energies. And to me, your experiences in the Mu chamber really sort of kind of validated that, even though it didn't make any sense. And I want to say that you know, when I think about it, there's really nothing very esoteric about that. I mean, you know, in electricity, for instance, if you have a wire and you put electricity through it, there's a certain field when the wire is straight. Then if you take the wire and wrap it into a coil, the same wire, same length, same electric current going through it, the field will change. It'll be a totally different field. So that, you know, in electricity, that's quite accepted. Somehow in the human body, it seems esoteric, and it's really not. And in that thought that the spatial arrangement of elements, you know, affects the energy flow, I also see contained your idea about the quality of the work. In that, for instance, the atomic structure of graphite and diamond is exactly the same, but the spatial arrangement of the molecules creates this totally different quality stone, and that the difference in quality we perceive as a higher vibrational level. And I also want to say that for me, I'm a very cerebral person, that the appropriate arrangement of words leads to a higher quality understanding that's beyond words.
Very good. I like that.
I guess there was no question.
One time had discussed various types of publications and even an idea of a book. And I'll let Joe take over from that. You're right on cue, Joe.
Well, I don't know about the publications. Actually, Ida is the one who was interested in having the material published in San Diego publications. What I was thinking about is what we should do with it is something on the idea of space, time, and beyond. There's a book, not necessarily a caricature drawing format, but a really readable, interesting book for the interested lay public. As we get these ideas across, rather than learned articles in scientific journals that were written by a couple of scientists in a couple of universities.
I really like that idea. The graphics and those charts and things were presented in an eye-appealing manner. I think it could be really valuable to people. There's obviously an enormous market right now. The public is very hungry for more data about that type of phenomenon.
Something like Psychology Today or something that would speak to the whole kind of population might be a...
Let's go to the Disney Studio.
Well, what you get into is the whole explanation of bodies are energy. And that actually is worth getting into in a popular type way. I mean, it's a financially good thing, and it's relatively respectable.
I particularly liked it because I think the data could be very valuable to the layman. And if it was presented right, people would get to take a look at that phenomenon without necessarily hearing a rap about Rawlkin.
Yeah.
So the conclusion or the basis around it was about Rawlkin and its changes, but it's not exactly like we were advertising Rawlkin. So I think it could turn two purposes there that can be really good.
I feel that way, it'd be valuable. I also feel that its value would be enhanced if it had some scientific publication behind it.
Yeah, well, I'm assuming that that will happen also.
Yeah, well, Valerie was saying to Ida yesterday that she's planning to do that, even though she hasn't picked a publication. I guess each publication has its own format and all that jazz, and so she hasn't really written it up for that yet. She was saying, and I don't know how it is, that it would be, you know, after she gets it written up, it's all pretty smooth, then you just take out sections and redo them a little bit for each publication. That's the scientific kind.
I talked to her yesterday, and she told me that she would be supplying us with a series of slides, and as you know from the comments yesterday, all the things that we saw were not necessarily from the Rolf project. Quite a few of them were. A good example of that was green that was on the graph. She said they found almost virtually no green. It wasn't until later that they even got into a range of what green was all about. So in that particular instance, the green was not real for the project. And how that's interpreted and put together could be really interesting. I would love to tackle some of that and putting it together. I think that's really interesting. I got a big charge out of that.
Doing some of the visuals.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I think they're really, that Valerie's really doing herself a disservice because she's got some fascinating information which you almost have to guess from the way it's presented.
If I was just thinking that those charts that you say, you know, you have to be practically an engineer to understand, if you can get those charts to the place where they are understood, they provide a sort of triangulation about it. That's really quite beautiful. And I don't think it would be too hard to do.
I like the idea of a paperback along the ideas of, you know, physics concepts. I think a lot of people are looking for something like that. If you give them the hard data, they just don't know what to do with it. They'll show it to somebody.
We don't.
Yeah. Well, the first study we had done, which I thought was a very valuable study, Val did. You know, take the hard data of the people, even who understood it, and they would tend to invalidate it because it proved so much. I just like the idea of a simpler book myself.
Also, one thing that needs to be in that book is ways in which that connects up with real life. Because one of that same study, that San Jose study, that study pointed to a lot of things that were true and nobody knew what to do with it. You know, there was no way that it connected.
One of the other things I think would be neat, I bet you we could get just a short blurb of the brain-mind bulletin, and also a good thing would be science, which is the other dimension. But I think if there was something in the brain-mind bulletin, we may get some responses and some people who are really being turned on to things, getting some useful information.
And part of that same book could conceivably be the whole business with that Texas research place that's doing topographical.
Where is that? Houston.
Oh, Houston. There's a
Biostereometrics.
Biostereometrics. You explain it. I'm not prepared with that.
Oh yeah, it's fine. It's a set of essentially what it is an aerial photography adapted to the human body. It's it's true.
I know, but yeah, it sounds neat.
It's done with stereo camera. It takes front and another stereo camera back picture of the body, and the picture is processed through a machine that gives you then like a relief picture that is stored in the computer, and then you can, you know, output it from the computer in numerical form, and you can perform all kinds of analyses like density to kind of, you know, given a density model, center of gravity of the whole thing over various settings and so on. And then compare, you know, between two data sets, like a before and after. You can draw relief maps of the body.
And the relief maps of the body are the one that is so pleasing because they're visually, what they do is they give you a visual that makes, you know, it's a series of lines, like a topographical map. And anybody can then look at a before and after photograph and the same photographs in this relief net form, and suddenly the, at least part of what goes on with that body just drips out.
You could also, obviously, the difference between the two bodies in the relief map format.
Yeah.
So that you wouldn't have to have two pictures, you could just have one picture, which would be the difference.
Yeah, which would be the difference, and that's an additional one. And there's a way in which, you know...
It'd be a weird body.
Huh?
It'd be a weird body, that was the difference.
Yeah, it would look weird if you body did the difference.
But there's, I mean, there's a way in which it, one of the purposes that kind of a book is to give people ways of images and other things of knowing what we're talking about. You know, and Val Hunt's are such images, and this other thing are such images, you know, one comes from inside, one comes from outside.
Is it possible, Rosemary, in terms of a learning tool? You were saying that when you look at these graphs, whatever they call them, that you can suddenly get some new pictures on how to see bodies.
Absolutely.
Is it possible to either get some of these pictures
for classes?
Well, for training, just to look at bodies, or if it's a real useful thing, maybe invite somebody to come and show us how this stuff works at the
It's too extensive and detailed a technique to try and use in terms of classes. I think we do better
with six bodies in a row. No,
I
wasn't thinking about bringing it to a class per se. I was just wondering, like, if we had 20 slides of these things or something,
sure,
you know, of these bodies, if it would help in terms of our seeing in some way.
Yes, and I think from my own personal point of view, it's more worth it for the public than it is for classes, because we cover that base in a lot of ways in a much more sophisticated fashion.
Okay.
Well, the problem with including that material in the book combined.
Now then, you got in the first hour. Will you be getting more change in the fourth hour today than you got in the first hour? Where do you get the change in the scanning on these bodies? Now, if you really want to know some more about Rolfing, this is what this is designed to give you. Where in the 10 sequences of Rolfing do you really get the change in the scanning? That's the object of the exercise that you've been performing this week.
Well, for me, it's too early to answer those, although I'm beginning to get some feeling like the difference between a pre-first and a pre-11th hour is very different.
All right, that's what I want. This is part of it.
But that's...
it's not too early to answer it. You can always answer, you know, tentatively on your way along. You've given one answer right there. Now, which of you had ideas about the 11th hour versus the first hour? All right, let's hear them.
Well, in the ones, yeah, well, I scanned like two or three, but the difference that I was aware of in that very limited sample was the 11th hour, his overall energy level of his chakras was fairly even. And the main problem...
Wait a minute. After or before?
Before.
Before the...
Compared with the pre-first hour, in which there's more unevenness as I scanned the body.
Certainly.
So he was more even. And the major problem that I sensed in him was a lack of connection between, in his case, the third and fourth chakras. That he was generally in an even...
I'm trying to picture which was your model.
David.
Oh yes, oh yes. You were David's practitioner.
No, I didn't. I just scanned him.
Dean was the practitioner.
Dean was, and David. Okay, so go on, Lloyd.
Well, that was quite pronounced in my perception of him. That scanning his whole body, the level felt fairly uniform to me.
For the 11th hour.
Yeah, before the 11th. And the people before the first hour, I felt a lot more up and down.
All right, this is fine. Now, after the first hour and after the 11th hour, did you find differences in the amount of energy which had been put into that body during that hour of work?
Well, I'd say yes, but
What would be the proportion?
I'd say I mean, this, I hadn't thought of this, and but just off the top of my head, I'd say there was more energy put into the 11th hour because...
more relative change in energy in the 11th hour. Now, I'm not arguing with you.
I'm not sure that's true.
Certainly it is, because the body's going to be more receptive to change in the 11th hour.
Well, it is, but also there's some places in the first hour that there's just a really big energy change in a local area. That wasn't as...
Even so, it shouldn't be.
Yeah. Right. I can't answer that yet.
Yes,
well, I have a different kind of consideration. What I see happening is that we're scanning the body, we're doing the Rolfing, and then we're scanning the body. And so it's as if we're looking at a certain level of energy coming from the body, we're measuring that, and then we're dropping that. And we're Rolfing the person, and then we say, okay, let's see if there's any changes. And my consideration is that there should be a level of intent to redirect or to change the focus so that the focus is with the Rolfing to direct change of the energy coming out of the body. In other words, if you're going to scan the body, when we look at a body, and we're looking at a body from the point of view of being Rolfers, we look at that something that has a disorganization, and we want to put organization into the structure. Mm-hmm. I think at the same time we can increase our focus and broaden the scope of it, since we're going to look at the body in a different way, which is scanning, that the information we get from the scanning, that we should be able to, through the Rolfing, direct a new focus into the body to bring out the kind of energy that we want to see, I think there should be some kind of a change in focus. I mean, if we're going to get these tools, we've got to learn how to use them. And I can see a better place to do that than right here.
I don't agree with you.
I think you just do the Rolfing.
I don't agree with you. I am worried that as you're laying it out now, what you're going to try to do is spot work.
No, I wasn't thinking that at all.
Well, I'm talking about spot work within the general first hour, let's say. And that I would do not want to see happen.
Well, it's possible to have spot work in terms of intention as well as spot work in terms of
right.
Hands.
That's
right. I think that's the... You know, so that your intention becomes, okay, fourth chakra low, I'm going to intend that fourth chakra high, I'm going to intend that fourth chakra high. Whereas what you're really intending is for the field to unify,
yeah.
And let's see then what happens to the fourth chakra.
Yeah, yeah. You brought out the point that is bothering me.
Something else here that relates to Lloyd, and that is that I don't have all four of them, but I have my after first hours and 11th hours. And the thing that was striking to me after the 11th hour, they started in a better place. And they started in a fairly unified place because I think both the people I checked were your people, Joseph's people. But the volume of energy through, and I don't mean volume in terms of glass,
I
mean volume in terms of the wideness of the field, seemed to be something I could perceive in the 11th hours and could perceive less in the first. In other words, if I had taken my hands and put them at both ends of that body, I would have had something, I mean, big and a sense of being able to feel my way through the whole body. And even with the improvement after the first hour, I had that less.
Yeah, I think that there's a difference in what we're looking at between the first hour and the 11th hour. In the first hour, what seems to me to happen is we have a random pattern of energy coming off the chakras. In other words, you know, one might be high, one's low, one over here, over there.
Also, a random pattern of quality.
Yeah, and quality.
Yeah.
It's more green.
And what the first hour does is it establishes a pattern in the chakras on a very elementary level. But that's significant. There's a pattern right in the first hour.
That introduces them
introduced into the chakras. And in the 11th hour, the chakras have a certain uniformity. But what we're dealing with there is not so much the alteration of a random pattern of chakras, but we're altering a random pattern of connection between the chakras. See, the what Brew remarked about in terms of David was how we were moving the or changing the flow that David had moving to his heart chakra, which was very low before the 11th hour and increased dramatically after the 11th hour. So we're dealing more with the dynamics in the 11th hour and the flow between the chakra. And we're dealing more with a static in the first hour in terms
of... Hold on a minute. I'm not completely clear as to what you said.
Yeah.
Are you saying that in that 11th hour, for instance, mm-hmm. you enliven the fourth chakra, or are you saying that you got a better connection across the diaphragm? You see what I'm kind of where I'm hung up.
Right. See, the truth is we did both, but in the 11th hour, you see, in our scanning, what we did is we had two variables, whether there was any energy pulsation at all over the chakras, and whether or not, and the other variable is whether or not there was a connection between chakras that were adjacent to one another. And see, the thing is that before the 11th hour, there was energy coming off the chakras. Now, it was increased in the 11th hour,
but
the most dramatic result was the increase in flow between adjacent chakras.
Not between adjacent chakras.
Between the chakras.
Between the general pattern of the body.
Yes.
And that's really important to me.
Right, and you know exactly what Rosemary said, if you put one hand at one end and the other hand at the other end, the flow between the hands was dramatically increased, which was not necessarily the most significant thing that happened in the first hour.
You sort of hinted at that, but you couldn't get that picture in the first hour.
Would you say that those of you that have this perception and have gotten this perception and have heard it today and so forth and so forth, that's your money's worth right there?
Yes. That's my practical money's
worth. This is what you came to find. This is the plus that you've gotten on your robbing in this class. And I hope
there's
you all
a way
feel how big a plus it is, how significant a plus it is. Because you see, before you were running a recipe, and you had learned to see a certain number of things. But now you're really beginning to make a whole of the things that you've been doing. And this is a mighty important thing for each and all of you, and it gets more important as you think about it more. So I'm sort of content, but I think you've gotten what you come for. That doesn't say you're not going to get some more. Now, today we're coming up the fourth hour. And today, you see, you are going to begin to look at some of these old beliefs. In earlier, more primitive societies, it has always been assumed that it is the pelvis which is the most important segment of the body in terms of body functioning. The pelvis was doing okay, the body was doing okay. Now, is this so? Have bodies changed? Have they changed down through the years? Did this assumption really, actually, simply reflect where those earlier, more primitive people were living? Is it that somehow in the progress of our civilization, in the taking up tremendous numbers of our people to operate in their heads instead of in their lower bodies? Is this changing the whole picture of humans? If so, can you see it? Do you see it? Does it become apparent in the work on the fourth hour? As you organize the fourth hour, how much more energy do you put into that body than you put into it, let's say, as you put that 11th hour through? is this fourth hour that you're going to be doing today, giving them a 25% increase in general energy, general body energy? Or is it giving them as much of a percentage as you believe you gave them in the first hour? And don't consider your 11th hour now. You haven't gotten to it yet, you see. Now, are you beginning to understand the problem that's being posed to you in this class a little bit better? You were very self-satisfied, Chuck.
It just means I'm worried.
How do you feel about it?
Well, going back just a step from that, again, I think we ought to begin to emphasize as opposed to emphasize quality as opposed to quantity of chakras. In other words, if a chakra, this one's going boing, 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 and it feels coarse against your hand, I'd much rather have one that's just going, and you have this tremendous feeling of expansiveness.
Well, okay, you can put quality into this fourth versus the first.
Sure.
Nobody's mad.
And what I saw on the, say, after 11 and after 1 was that the field shifted to a much finer state more rapidly.
Yeah, but now remember that your fourth is between the 11 and the 1. Don't get it messed up. Don't think that your 11 was number 2 and that your fourth is coming after that. It's not. And this is giving you a certain amount of confusion, but on the other hand, unless that first and 11th hour had been put together, it might have been difficult for you to have seen a difference in what you got in the first and what you got in the 11th. How do you feel about it, Joe?
I feel that what we're going to be dealing with, I think that what we're going to be dealing with in this session is to see if the energy really comes up from below. If doing the pelvic set, a pelvic hour will allow a connection to the whole body as the energy comes up from below,
mm-hmm.
or if, you know, if that doesn't happen, then we may have to sort of revise our thinking about that, or open up our thinking to other possibilities.
You see, in making these observations and doing this kind of consideration, what you are really considering is the historical progression of humankind, possibly. Probably, not certainly. Rosemary, you got something to add?
Well, not to that, but I would expect that just about at the level of the fourth hour, something personal would be happening in terms of the fourth. And that is that you might start getting, in other words, what I see happening before the fourth hour in terms of my seeing, is that the problems have started to clarify themselves. And so the body isn't necessarily more unified in one respect. It's showing itself more. And I'm wondering if that would reflect itself in the chakras as, on the one hand, a clearer energy, and on the other hand, a greater disparity between the chakras.
It would be extremely happy, fortuitous circumstance if somehow or other we managed to get an unspoiled savage from Pogo Pogo or Pogo Pogo or somewhere or somewhere.
Joseph will get you one.
As unspoiled as possible.
Rare, medium, or well done.
And we could really examine an individual who had been less subjected to the kind of cultural pressures that have been evident in Western Europe, which have changed the bodies of Western Europeans.
So
would be extremely interesting, and I don't think we're ever going to be able to do it. Yes?
Well, I thought a lot about that when I was in Tahiti. I've taken a couple of trips to Tahiti, and the remarkable things about the Tahitians is the mobility of their pelvis, as seen, for instance, in some of their dances, and the fluidity of their movement. And yet there's a completely different arrangement of the body. It's as if they have a much stockier torso sitting on that pelvis than what we see in kind of the what's considered the better body type here.
Well, there's very little doubt in my mind that the better body type, the better type, the better human type
legs
here puts the emphasis on the throat chakra. Not on the head chakra now, but on the throat chakra. How do you feel about that one? Argue? I don't mind arguing.
That matches up with the connection with the second chakra, too.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a connection between those two, and that's congruent for me.
That as a result of the strains which we have put into this culture, the civilization, you have gotten a certain amount of transmutation, you see, of energy from that second chakra up to that fifth chakra. And nowadays, we're putting the emphasis in our educational development, on fifth chakras, on communication, on how do you talk, why do you talk, have you good vocabulary, do you know how to use it? I mean, all of this whole trip of the educated man is in the fifth chakra. Now, what was the trip of the educated man 3,000 years ago? I don't know, frankly.
Well, there's that wonderful story that Jung tells, that he met, this was an American Indian, but he said that it was true of many cultures, that, I don't know how the story goes anymore, but it was to the effect that the Indian told Jung that the location of the mind to him was in the heart. And Jung said that for modern man, the location of the mind is in the brain. And
I don't think it's gotten as high as the brain yet.
Yeah, I agree with you.
The crown chakra has not.
No, this would have been the pineal, but I agree with you. And so Jung said that, and the Indian said that they must feel crazy all the time. Which Jung thought was true.
Well, this is a very interesting set of considerations for you to apply to your attempted estimations of where and how energy is located in a given body. And it's an interesting set of...
Do you mean located or sent out?
Located or...
Or sent out.
Sent out.
Emitted.
Well, I don't think you're sending out very much in a deficient set from a deficient area, are you, Rosemary?
You could be leaky. No, I'm serious. I'm really serious. I'm not playing a game. In fact, I think a deficient system is exactly that. It's a system that leaks rather than expresses.
You said leak,
leak.
Or leak?
Leak.
Leak.
Leaks.
P or K?
K.
Oh, I was thinking of P. I mean, the vision that I had in my mind, and this has a certain amount of pertinence too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it does. Is it just a continual transmutation, and that loses energy too?
Mm-hmm.
Or not transmutation, but...
Well, you see, one of the things that has interested me through a large part of my adult life, when I was quite a young woman in my 20s, let's say, I was in touch with and I was influenced a lot by an old blind osteopath. And part of his vocabulary was that the energy was leaking. It is leaking from here and there. And I was very superior in those days because I was a member of the staff of the Rockefeller Institute, and I knew that energy didn't leak. But I didn't tell him that. I was tactful. My mama taught me to be tactful.
Okay.
Well, we ought to congratulate her. She did a good job.
But you hear what I'm saying to you. How there is all of these options in the way energy expresses through a something which we call personality, how it behaves. What is the difference in what the neighbors perceive in the personality that's leaking and the personality that's leaping? All of these are considerations which are appropriate for you people to be spending your time and your sleepless nights thinking about. Because you now have the skill, or you very nearly have the skill, within your hands, within your personalities, to estimate this. And see how you will estimate given people now versus how you would have estimated it when you first came into Roth. How we can be thinking about this. How at this point, to what extent at this point are you or any other good Ralpha able to change those patterns, willing to change those patterns, willing to take on the responsibility of changing those patterns, ethically entitled to change those patterns, assuming that you can. You've swapped off some old problems for some brand new ones, and they're twice as bad, the new ones. You looking at me with a question in your eye, Mr.?
Just a lot of love.
See, I can't distinguish anymore between love and passion. My hard luck. Anyway, what else do you want to throw into the pot before we take on the models?
Could we play with the word grounding for a minute?
Yeah.
As it relates to chakras and balance. And as it relates to the fourth hour.
Well, what do you want to say about grounding?
I want to say that it's a matter of balance. A matter of.
I don't think so. Well, in the larger sense, of course, it is.
One of the things I see in the flesh, the way that I look at it, is like looking at the rectum and how we have, there's a very strong pattern, particularly in males, of a real strong drawing up, which is like our, something in the basic personality of man draws himself up away from coming down, which I'm experiencing more in my body since the work is that I can just rest down and then I feel connected, as opposed to something that was pulling me up, that was not connected,
well,
down.
I think you are seeing a pattern in males, which is really a pattern in being. If you look around you at these other males, you'll see that they present very different patterns. They're not pulling up as you were.
Yeah, well, I'm not referring to the raw, to us as a group. I'm just speaking more culturally. I see a real strong tendency toward that.
It's part of the cultural group, and it isn't.
It
isn't quite as random as the cultural group, but still the same. I don't know.
I get a sense of what he's talking about, and I feel it's not as much of an up as it is an in. You see, a lot of men are drawn into their pelvis,
yeah.
And that's why they have such bad rotating problems.
I
mean,
well,
men
I think that they grow into their pelvis because mama has put a trip on them at age 4. About how they pay no attention to what's going on below their waist.
Well, I agree, probably 100% right. I'm just saying that I see what Dean is saying, and I agree that in a lot of men you see that they're drawn into their pelvis. It's like things, it's like they're, well, that's why they're glutei, and in the first session we're looking to get width through the pelvis. It's drawn in together. Most men really hold with their buttocks. They really hold on to their anal sphincters.
I think psychologically what it has to do with me somewhat is that I felt that there was like a line in me that was I was driving forward. And my personality was driving.
You were driving forward rather than driving up.
Yeah. And like, to use Rosemary's type of imagery, is that I was sitting down by the pool and I thought of myself as that energy of a ram, up going up, that driving with the top of the head, but it was like coming from down there. Mm-hmm. And my new space and my new sense of more connectedness and more grounding is like when I come back and that no longer there isn't that.
Well, now wait a minute. You've used the word which Roger threw into the pool, namely grounding. And when you use that word, what are you talking about? And what do you visualize in your mind's eye? And what do you look at in another individual to see whether, as he just presents himself to you as a stranger, is this man grounded?
I get a sense of grounding from the configuration of the pelvis. I get a sense of, you know, it's like I don't have words to really see. It's like I just see the body and it tells me something. And what I see is a connectedness to the earth, a solidness. It's like people who are in the martial arts, and not just the people who are playing it, but the real masters, tend to have like such a solidity.
That's right.
And such a connection here down, and that their intention is to use that to move the energy that we get here and
now
be able to project.
Look at those same men in your mind's eye. Did you ever see any of them that didn't have their feet literally on the ground? I don't mean flat-footed.
No, they all do.
They all do.
They work at it for years before they move their hands in any direction.
And you see, those martial arts people recognize the fact that actual grounding, and by that I mean communication with the earth, comes through the feet. Now, there are other people, and there are mighty good people, but they follow a different pattern, like Brew, who never knew he had feet, who never knew there was a ground under them.
I think that that's, again, we're getting the area of the template, where maybe there's two models, the physiological model of perhaps the actual grounding of the fascial system, which is one of my imagery. That it's the system and network of grounding in the physical sense, that it takes whatever this energy field that we are and provides a grounding system, a network. It's a pathway for that. And in addition to that, we also have the chakra system, which is one and the same again, but it is in combination of the physical form of the matter in the feet and in this, what we're going to be dealing with today. And in the first chakra is going to be more of that finer body connection with the template of the physical connection. Or just some things I
do. Well, I don't know. As far as I'm concerned, I don't see a first chakra as being the first chakra. Mm-hmm. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, these legs are not just extraneous things set onto a body.
Right. That's what the
fourth. Or set onto a consciousness either.
That's right.
I would like to add one word to, because I think it's confused with balance and grounding, and that is centering.
That is?
Centering. Because people, I think, make the confusion, is someone grounded with, is someone centered? And I see Brew as extremely centered.
Yes.
But not grounded.
Well, he's...
Or less grounded.
Less grounded.
And often you can get centering through your groundedness, but those are really separate considerations.
Getting centered.
Yeah.
So first chakra, I was thinking, it is the first chakra in the sense that it's the first place where things come together and become one. We have two legs, and the energy comes up two legs.
Yeah, well,
joins
it's also
the
thing that you know perfectly well. A man can live after his legs are cut off. He certainly isn't living too well.
I would also like to advance here the notion that there's something else involved here, which is the center of gravity. And I have this notion that in the evolution of man, the center of gravity is going
up. It's been rising.
It's been rising.
It's quite probable.
The thing that I was talking about.
Partly because they haven't been standing up, those earlier.
Well, right. Yeah, but I'm talking about, it's like, the thing about the Tahitians that I noticed is that their legs are seem in proportion, I'm talking about, shorter and stockier, especially the femurs seem considerably, the thighs seem considerably shorter than kind of the average Western body type.
But not short in the sense, in a romping sense of being tight.
No, not particularly.
Well, they lean more toward an oriental body.
Yeah.
Longer in the upper part and shorter in the bottom
shorter
part.
The
they do just the opposite. Perfect contrary example of that is you go to Mexico. Everybody in Mexico, with few exceptions, is short-waisted. And they're much smaller on top, but they always go this way. I mean, they're really very barrelly. You go to Scandinavia, it's different. So the template's different. I think that when we start to get rolfers into other countries and compare notes, we're going to find it's really interesting. There's a real difference in structure. And the most interesting thing about rolfing starting in America is that this is really a random city.
Yeah. Well, in Hawaii, you see...
Multicultural.
Hawaii, you see that the pelvis is turned under in Hawaiians.
Yeah.
They tend to walk with a very fine gravitational line. They walk on their center. And what you see in Americans who've gone over there, that you would expect they have a pelvic tilt. Especially in occupations like cocktail waiters where they have to wear high heels and stuff, is that their pelvises begin to turn under also. That normally if you go into a lounge where you have that kind of, you have people serving drinks and stuff, their pelvises are very aberrated. In Hawaii you don't see it as much. You see it, you only see it in tourists. And even in tourists, their pelvis begins to turn under a little bit. It's interesting. I think it has to do with being around the water or something. But you see less aberrations over there in the pelvis than you do here.
Well, that's an interesting and accurate observation.
I want to continue on the center of gravity. It seems to me that the evolution we're talking about is also evident in the individual evolution from baby to adult, in that the proportion of legs to torso changes.
Yes, of
in
course.
That course
this is so.
And the center of gravity goes up. I think that the species is paralleling there.
No question about that.
For the grounding that the martial arts gets is really very different because they're taking the center of gravity down.
Mm-hmm.
Purposely.
They're taking
no,
the center
lighting.
Down.
Connection
they're aligning. They're not. It's the process of connecting. But
center of gravity is a physical thing. You can't take it anywhere. It just is in your body.
Well, if you bend your knees, it's
yeah, that's what I mean. You bend your knees and you get it closer to the ground.
But true master, you won't get what we tend to think about as being, what we see and experience from people doing Tai Chi, and that their bodies do lengthen and they've worked to the maximal extent of creating length in their body. When they met,
shortness in the leg,
a true master. I don't. The ones that I've seen, and there aren't that many of them, but the pictures I've seen of them, they've got a lot of length and a lot of ability.
Length in the legs.
And in the legs.
They have an ability to lengthen, but it's an ability to lengthen into their art. Their bodies aren't lengthened.
Yeah.
My master was 75, and he was an extraordinary man. He was very small. He used to walk around like this. But all of a sudden he'd get into his art and everything in his body would come up and he had this incredible movement. And I, it was marvelous to watch him. But the way he moved, when he wasn't in that template, he was down as anybody else. So I don't know.
Apparently he was down a little more than most of
them. That may very well be. They do have the space for the length. How they work with it in their life. It would be a matter of personality.
So you don't think that the principle of grounding for a martial arts master is to get below to the ground.
No.
As a place from which to
it's
work
connected.
Out.
Unless, well, depends on the martial art.
They're also
judo, you see, they seem to be a little lower than some of the other.
And that's the least of all of the martial arts.
I think that the fascinating thing about Rolfing is that we're not so much concerned with the center of gravity.
we're not focusing our attention on whether the center of gravity is in the pelvis or in the thorax or which one's more important than the other. I think that in Rolfing, we've gotten to the next step, which Drew has talked about as being the arrival of the Kundalini energy, and the Kundalini energy is the energy which travels in a straight vertical line with all channels open. And I think that what we're interested in Rolfing is the vertical line. I don't pay a whole lot of attention when I'm Rolfing to where the center of gravity is. I do pay a lot of attention to where the vertical line is and whether that's functional. One of the observations that I generally make in after a fourth hour is that I don't know how it's done, but I can see a lot of change blocking out the legs in the torso, and what I see in the torso is a sense of a vertical line through the core. That's what vertical is if they're standing up.
But it seems to me you can read that as a kind of upward floating, which you could if you wanted to interpret as rising of the center of gravity.
Yeah, you could interpret it that way if you're trying to explain it to somebody, but I don't usually try to explain it to anybody. I mean, you know, we've gone through trying to explain that, well, what we did is we freed the pubic coccygeus and everything above it bounced up. I don't think that's the whole story. You know, and possibly there are fascial connections, which might be another model that we could use. I don't know. I'm not a whole lot concerned with the model, except I am concerned about that experience of a core verticality that seems to begin to come in at the end of the fourth hour. So what I would be doing, say if I were going to use this energy stuff, is I would not be too concerned with whether the root chakra were pulsating a lot, and I'd be surprised if it were. But I would be looking at the qualitative difference that Chuck was talking about, because yeah. I think that influence on the core is what begins to change the quality of the energy pulsation. And
I mean, it makes sense that we do refine the field because we do refine the flesh.
How to use it. I'm not interested in martial arts, and you know, I never would.
That's not true. You obviously know how to use it. You do it all the time.
Yeah, intuitively. But I mean, I don't know how to use it consciously, you know, functionally. Well, what do I do now that I have my center of gravity up higher? It doesn't change anything for me. But what is important to me is the vertical line.
I take an opportunity in the fourth hour, I stand people up in front of the mirror, and I get them into an idea or a concept of concentric circles from their center. And I talk to them about that center moving constantly, going through that process of establishing a different kind of balance, which is the verticality that he's talking about. But I don't talk about it from front to back. I'm really talking about it in terms of a circle, two concentric circles that are going on. And it's that pattern that most people experience as down. It literally is down for them. And the fourth hour is a great one because you can show them on the flesh where that circle's going.
Listen, boys and girls, we got to get going. We got to get stopped. Well, you ever hear about rolling up the seat?
So the fourth will move that leg over under center,
so we're gonna,
and it suddenly changes.
Let's resonate for a second.
Pictures are all taken. They're ready for
it.
Okay, Chris, come on up. Why don't you take a look at her and just get a quick image of what's going on
here to be stronger than below here and above the plus four to be stronger.
Well, what do you feel about the first three?
Yeah, I'll give you that.
The second and third, I would expect to have much less energy.
or a different connection of energy.
Do you feel that there's a possibility that the third is too close to the second?
I would have put it the third is too far from the fourth, but it's, I'm not saying the same thing. And that these two are too close.
That's a, makes for separation.
I'm not sure of that.
Yeah.
But go ahead, get this poor girl off the hook. So in other words, you've been down in Los Angeles, not in San Francisco.
The last month and a half.
Oh, yes. So how do the rest of you feel about this one?
What we find here is that we're changing the
there seems to be a lot of connection between the diaphragm and this pelvic
fat. Yeah, they're too close.
They're too pulled into each other, straining towards each other.
Which I think would then also bring these two chakras too close together.
And from the back, it looks as though there's some tension on coming up through here that probably has something to do with that.
Now, see to what extent this model demonstrates my words right now of how you can look at those various parts of the body and you can literally see the energy at different levels, most of it up there, actually, second down here, and very much dragging its feet around the
diaphragm. Are you saying second in the first? Second in the first or second at the knees?
No, I'd say between the umbilicus and the knees is the second level. With more here, really, if you need to. But going down to zero, right across that diaphragm. And you don't need any skin. Anyway, he's going to get out of this.
A little bit more lift.
And then you that's going to put it in, it's he that's going to put it in, and he'll feel it after you've lifted up his chest some more, I think.
Okay.
What I mean is he won't do it until you've lifted up that chest. That's what I really mean.
All right. I was imagining that that would wait till a fifth session to do that. Do you want me to start on that?
Well, I would put some of that in before I let him go. Again, I don't mean to say do a fifth session on him, but.
And it's still, I think I'm starting from the inside of my leg.
Okay, go ahead. Okay. Now, who's going to be your scanner?
I don't know.
Hi, Nicholas.
I'll be glad to do one.
Okay, who's missing a status road here? Everybody's here. Who has done an hour check?
We only have two coming up.
Would you like to do an hour check?
Nope, there's two more right there.
We have three all together.
Okay.
Would you like to do an hour?
No, I can, but if you can't do it, there's volunteers.
Hey, didn't I say that we weren't leaving Roger's head until a 7th hour thing? That's tomorrow. Come on, Roger, get to work. Who do you think you are getting hours ahead of time every day? Would you care to pick up one of these slaves at the auction?
I'll volunteer.
What's your problem with the scanning sheets are right there.
Now, what comment does anybody have?
This is the 4th hour, right?
This is the 4th hour. What comment do you have to make about yourself, Eddie? Are you perceptive enough of yourself to comment on yourself?
Yes. Okay. So. There's compression on the right side over here, especially down in this area.
There's a depression?
Compression.
Compression.
On the right side. And between the third and the fourth session, there's been a lot of disorganization in the body, and different muscles would pull and hurt that
hadn't
pulled
right
before.
That's all right.
But there has been a shift in awareness to like deeper muscles of the body rather than being focused so much in exterior shift.
Sit down again and see what you feel as you sit. you feel how you took care of yourself that time, but the time before when you sat without being self-conscious, can you go back and find that in your memory?
No, I can't. Yeah. But I don't feel balanced. You know, I do feel different pulls, especially after the long drive up here. Mm-hmm. There's a pull.
That isn't where it is. When he sat down before, he came down as though he had a ton of brick between here and here. No, you're holding yourself. It's all right. You should hold yourself all the time.
Okay.
But the point was that that was giving you the indication of that fourth hour problem that he has. Okay, two scanners needed. Oh, here's the next.
Hello.
Hello. You wanted to pick yourself a nice little man.
I didn't know it was Randy.
You know, what do you
do?
Where's Crow?
Where's Crow?
Do you golf anymore? Do you golf anymore?
What they're doing is
do golf.
Do I do it?
Uh-huh.
Practically not anymore.
Will that get me in time?
So what do you see? What I see is that Mama or Papa or teacher told that guy to stand up straight. That's right. Now take some nice big breaths. Now that's the way to feel good. And he's been hanging on to his chest ever since, feeling good under those directions. And as a result, he's got that rigidity through the entire chest, and it is pushing down. I mean, it is being too heavy. I think so. Does that sound to you like anything you've gone through?
I think there's a lot of rigidity. My top part of my body is heavier than anywhere else. And I feel like it could be sinking me down. Why do I think that? I'm not sure why. The weight seems to go here.
What did Papa tell you and what did teacher tell you about standing up straight?
Well, they would tell me to stand up straight. They also would tell me to eat all the good Greek food that my mother cooked, which I have been doing.
I don't think the food that your mother cooked had much to do with it.
I just came from four patterning sessions, and I'm really being very conscious about standing and trying to balance.
But she's not balanced now.
No.
The way you're standing, the way you're going, the pattern you're going into,
holding
you're balanced. You're not balanced. See if you can get that guy to understand what balance is. You're going to have to supplement the fourth session with some work up on the shoulders. But I do the fourth session really well first.
You do the fourth first?
Yeah. You see? Well, it might.
He's got no
core. The bottom might help the top, too.
He's got no core.
I get your right knee.
It'll come.
No, I mean, that's what's happening now. That's why we're falling.
Yeah, that's
the
right. He has no core. That's
he's got
right.
Nothing going out. It's like the,
that's right.
It's
and
like
he's
a hollow
working,
fountain.
He's working so hard to
yeah,
get it.
Right.
And he's just had four patterning sessions looking for see what he's telling you. He's conscious of the fact that he wants something, and he's working very hard to get that something. And he can't get it. And one of the reasons he can't get it is because he's sick and he's performing the period. Okay. Goodbye.
Toes up and close.
I don't know how to put up.
Over here. And down. And up.
Toes up.
And down again.
Minimize the tightening muscle.
And up and down there.
Except it isn't moving truly, it's moving better, but it's
moving better. Cut down the ring.
Well, didn't get some nice changes in that dark side. Beautiful. Huh? Right.
Yeah, toes up again.
Yeah. Hurting a lot, Nicholas?
Now, Chuck, as you are doing that leg, look at how the other leg lies on that pillow, which I do not like at all. And be aware of its arrangement in space. No, take it out from under that. He doesn't need any pillow. Who is he, a 90-year-old lady?
Come on.
Now look at the different structural patterning of those two legs. Be aware of it. Now, the problem there is on the external malleolus, just above it, just in front of it.
How are you doing, Nicholas?
I'm all here.
Just hurting more than when Joe Howard does it?
Good. Well, it's a little bit different than when Joe does it.
Okay.
We have a bit better time because we laugh and make jokes. This is a little tense.
A little tense, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, sort of.
Yeah, it's all stuffy.
Put up and laugh.
Okay.
No, that's down.
Andy, tell us some jokes.
Andy's telling us some jokes.
He said that he felt that the jokes were part of the session.
Really?
Yeah, that's what Joe does.
No.
Yeah. He tells him jokes. Get in
there. Dr. Ralph will tell the jokes too, probably.
That's all right.
Tell him the story about Orson Bean.
Yeah, so when it opens up in here, it's like you're going right into it.
Goes up now?
Okay.
And down.
And now for up to back.
Just remember to lean back there and take a breath.
Without getting in.
Think about a funny story Joe told you.
Now
for a
picture
of that. Now look for that little toe. Bring your toes up towards your nose.
I can't hurt.
I know. And then the light pole, you get to see it at a different level. You get
last foot now.
Look at your space.
Now bring your foot up.
Bring your knee back.
Thank you.
Patrick, can you tell a rattlesnake story?
Foot up and down.
Tell him Joe's working with the seat of the frog.
Relax, put up down. Put up a little. Good. Now toes up here.
It's great.
Is it hurting too much, Nicholas?
I'm a little confused.
Yes.
Because I thought that the fourth session was on the pelvis. I'm confused about your working on my foot.
Under the foot. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about that, Nicholas.
Yeah.
You're going to be
client to complain.
I was all prepared for it.
Well, we're just starting at the other end, so to speak.
We've only just begun.
No, wait, you still got that right at the ankle. Try and find a ligament that just No, on the external malleolus. External malleolus.
I got it.
Oh, move. Play the harp on.
Solid. Solid. If I get this one too, I'm out. What if they?
The belly light.
That finger there has a fingernail, I think.
Yeah.
I think that all 10 of them have fingernails. That we don't accept people who be wrong just as they have.
Just trauma.
Right. So I'm comfortable.
Straight feel like going up.
No, we're not.
You like that feeling right down.
There. Gets too much, Nicholas, tell me.
Well, I think you're jamming your finger a little bit.
It's true. Is it too much?
No, you can strum it up from the bottom.
Put up and down. Put up. Feel better now?
Not really.
Huh?
It's smooth.
I don't remember what it was like before.
It's like your heel is reaching.
Lay your head down, please.
Before, when you moved it up, it sort of came up off the table in a wavy circular motion. Now it's starting to move towards the plane of the table. As you move.
Nicholas?
Yeah.
Bring your toes up, please. Your voice is dropping. That's it.
Things coming right
here. Put up and down, maybe?
Is this place feel up?
Yeah, it looks good.
As you're moving, it's like a short through here.
Still right around that angle.
Put up, Nicholas.
Yeah, then put it
down.
Put them right there.
Yeah, right.
Just go up inch by inch on the inside there. Put it up to the knee. Inch by inch. That's right, and slow your tempo down. And go all the way down till your fingers are very much aware of the bony surface.
Yeah.
Hard time.
too bad we have Joe Heller over here. I know he can make us a joke room.
That's good.
Joe, great Joe.
He's busy. You saw his hands up there. It's crushed.
Oh, wait. If that doesn't work, Dr. Rolfe knows a lot of stories.
Keep going right up that line.
Oh, yeah.
Nicholas is reporting that it's not even so much fun anymore.
That's too bad. Yes. Right in the
Oriental
and cake,
which
is this the Greek spot?
Well,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Oh, sure. But the top.